Yeah, good morning for everyone. So my name is Leandro Parente. I'm a researcher at OpenGeoHub, and here I will be presenting about an effort for monitoring livestock and agriculture system based in an ensemble approach using data harmonization strategies. And of course, I'm representing here a whole group of persons, so and people that it's not only at OpenGeoHub, but also like outside in different organizations, as for example the WRI and several use cases that we have. So this effort is part of kind of connected with several use cases. So the pipeline that I will be presenting here, it's basically enabling data integration for at least three use cases that we have in the project. So global monitoring systems for livestock and grassland and pastures. So crop yield monitoring system for Africa. So they need to have some crop mask as reference to start, for example, the yield monitoring. And also the land degradation neutrality tool, considering, for example, different land cover maps. So specifically about the use case 8 for the monitoring of grassland, pastures, and livestock. So OpenGeoHub, it's part of the Global Pasture Watch project. So it's basically a consortium of researcher partners developing global grassland livestock monitoring data. IASA, it's also part of that, together with WRI, LAPIG from the Federal University of Goiás in Brazil, GLAD, IDIF, so Cornell University, and this whole initiative is funded by the Land and Carbon Lab. And of course, we have also like different user communities. And within the context of this project, basically, we are producing four main products. So grassland class maps. So this is like annual 30 meter for cultivated and natural and semi-natural grassland using Landsat data, livestock density maps, also based in 1 kilometer data. Also annual, but in this case with 1 kilometer data. So it's basically number of animals per hectare, short vegetation high, where we are modeling the canopy high considering ISAT as input data, and also Landsat. This is an annual product, and the gross primary productivity that will be also presented here by my colleague from OpenGeoHub, Serkan, where we are basically modeling the GPP for different land cover types, but targeting it for grasslands. So, and specific about the grassland class, we are submitting, actually it was submitting, it's in the review revision process. So we submitted a manuscript describing all the methodology, and I will not go into the details here, but you can just check the publication. And now we have an early adopter program to make the maps accessible, but once the publication is out, everything will be open, including training data, input variables, and also the maps in different platforms, considering, for example, Stack and Google Earth Engine and these cloud native formats. And in this whole pipeline, it's important to say that we also develop a feedbacking strategy together with the colleagues from IASA to use GeoWiki to really retrieve some feedback about where we can improve the maps and where we have some sort of mismatch with the actual landscapes. So, and here are some examples. So for example, we have actually annual maps, and here I'm just showing the cultivated grassland for 2022. That's the last year of the time series. We are also delivering grassland probabilities. So when considering this threshold, we did some optimization process to find what is the best threshold considering some occurrence assessment. So in the case of the cultivated grassland, if we establish this threshold 0.32, that's the areas that we will classify as cultivated grassland. We did the same approach for the natural and semi-natural grassland. So you can see that the optimized threshold here, it's about 0.42. And if we combine them, basically we can have like a dominant class map from cultivated, it's one class, and natural and semi-natural grassland as another class. So, and again, this is like a time series, and we have a set of integration rules, and also the probabilities that are available. So everything it's open, and it's part of the Global Pasture Watch project. So, and what we did, so this is also like kind of in the discussion part of the manuscript. So the way that we see this product is it's basically like as building blocks. So we don't want to actually just put some map available and say, yeah, that's here's the map, you can just use the class as it is. So we actually want to provide some sort of flexibility for the users considering the probabilities, but even like also the training data, so they can maybe refit the models for a specific location to improve the accuracy, or they can use the probabilities to integrate with existing land use and land cover maps and things like that. So this is, so we think this is a very flexible approach, and here we basically illustrated two ways to do that. So the first one is together with our livestock density maps that we are producing. And these maps are still not ready yet, but we predicted it in the project, so we are working to delivering them. But once we have that, we can basically merge these two maps and really find where we have, here. So where we will have like livestock densities, and we can cross with the grassland products, and we can basically have active grazing areas. So of course there is some mismatch of resolution here, we need to harmonize that. But this it can really indicate areas where we have active livestock happening and areas we don't have it, considering these two maps. This is, for example, one application example. The other one is basically what Tom already talked in his talk. So basically, the ensemble land cover product where we can actually harmonize different land cover products that exist today and basically including the grassland maps. And provide like a kind of really seamless land cover map, considering all the ongoing initiatives. So what I will present in here, it's basically like an effort in this strategy, but considering agriculture focus, right? So and of course, thinking that this could really work as a building block. The solution that was implemented, it's also like very flexible to allow different rules of integration among all these maps, right? So what I will show here, it's basically some proposition of rules, but everything is open and the user can really adapt this for a different context or for a specific location. So, and that's basically a kind of overview if you think about global land cover maps, but also more specific agriculture products, right? So here I'm talking about data that it's basically produced with Landsat and Sentinel. So we have So we have basically the product developed by the Chinese Academy of Science that they did annual maps. So they have several classes. And also, this is the land cover produced by GLAD Group, so basically led by Matt Hansen. The Global Pasture Watch product, but this is just two classes, right? Grassland and natural, semi-natural grassland. Peter, also from GLAD, produced the global crop expansion, so 30 meter. So there is this nice data set that it's also available for in the OMC app. So this is basically soil cover for South America, and they are updating that. So, and you can see here, it's a small chunk considering the whole world, but it's the whole South America. And we also, I also added here so we can see how the integration will work, considering that even that for other areas we might not, of course we don't have it because it cover only South America, but it's a very valuable data because it's specific for a crop type. So, and all this data, of course, it's like time series based on Landsat. We have different time frequencies and things like that. So, and if you think about if we think about a baseline, so imagine that we want to harmonize and make a map only for 2020 where we can harmonize and combine all this data, right? So, and this increase like the data availability and the data possibilities that we have. So we have the Esri land cover map that is produced from 2018 to now. Of course, the as a world cover that will also be maintained by the as part of the Copernicus program now, right? And also the word serial that we are having a talk specifically about this product now. So, and all these products, they are available, of course, and they have different formats in different platforms. Sometimes you try to download them, and they are in tiles and things like that. So it's a bit difficult to integrate it. And because also it's a big chunk of data. So, and part of the effort here, it's really facilitate the access for all these products. So, and how exactly we are doing that? So basically, for the cultivated grassland, so here we defined some kind of rules. So considering that I want to produce a baseline for 2020, and I have yearly map, but for example, the agriculture data, it's actually a 3 or 4 year period considering what Peter developed by GLAD. So what I kind of suggested here as a kind of a standard rule is basically average the 5 years of grassland probabilities that we have and convert that for dominant class considering the probability threshold that I presented. And of course, this is grassland, like this is specifically the cultivated grassland that is there, but we can also merge this with different products. So for the GLAD, they don't have grassland, but they have this short vegetation map, short vegetation class for wetlands and like land, right? So we can use this and just assume as a kind of a binary map, and we can keep in going like that, right? So for as a word cover, we can do like grassland. For the Chinese map, we can use like herbaceous cover, cropland, and grassland, these two classes. And if you have it, basically you have like, for these four maps, we can have three of them agreeing that, okay, this is grassland, and we have agreement index about 0.75 in this case. So, and that's exactly what we're seeing here for a specific area in Brazil. So, and basically this is a kind of a exercise where I can show these rules, right? So I can basically do the same for the natural and semi-natural grassland. I will not pass for all the rules. We will have the slides later. And also for cropland, we have a bit more data. So the agreement index here have a bit more, we will have a bit more granularity. So, but basically it's, yeah, cropland for most of the products. So for example, in the Chinese map, we also have different class, like rain feed cropland. And for the word sear, we can work with this fraction cover of temporary crops. So here actually I put like 50, but in this case, so it's really like a range of 0 to 200. And okay, so, and after that, we can basically integrate this map, so considering some rules. So I can assume that the cropland might have some prevalence among the class, and I just integrate that, and now I have like a dominant class for these three classes, so cultivated grassland, natural and semi-natural grassland, and cropland. But of course, basically these were derived by this agreement index. So that's a kind of one way to do this integration. But how exactly we can implement that in a very flexible approach? So, and all the rules that I show, they are implemented here, and basically they consume directly global land use and land cover mosaics. So I show a small part of Brazil, but you can do this for any place in the world, in your notebook. Of course, if you want to process the whole world, you need to actually have at least some powerful workstation. But if you want to use for a test site or for a small area, you can just get this notebook and run directly in your machine. So because all the data that I show, it's prepared in global land use and land cover mosaic. So I'm talking about between 10 and 30 meters spatial resolution, and the integration rules, they are basically implemented in this computational notebook. So, but what exactly I'm talking about? So all the layers that I show, they are basically following the file naming convention that we defined in the OMC. And if you see that, here is the size of the data. So it's not really huge, right? It's only 1.2 terabytes we can put maybe in a hard drive, and you have the whole world for all the class that I'm showing here in a very flexible and easy way to access. And this is, for example, one practical use that we can make for these different data sets. So, and here's an example. So that's basically as a word cover, right? So it's of course, it's a very nice map. And here you can see the size of the image. You have a URL that it's public accessible, and you can basically go anywhere in the world and just visualize it directly in the QuantGIS, or you can work with small regions in your notebook, in a notebook session, or in your workstation. If you have the whole data, 1.2 terabytes, you can just do everything local processing and really have like your own integration. So you really don't need like Google Earth Engine to process that. Of course, you can implement that, but maybe some of these data sets will not be available there. So we truly believe that this is a kind of a more flexible solution. So, and here's some example, right? The rules, the integration rules are like that. You have full access here in this link, including the data. So what could be the next steps? So what will be the next steps here? So basically, we plan to register everything in our OMC stack. So basically, a data catalog where people can access all this data in a kind of a seamless and a programming environment, right? So you see that I didn't show the Esri land cover, so we are still preparing that. So, and download and put in the same format. And also the livestock densities, it's product that it's we want to use in the also in this pipeline, maybe to identify and split the kind of the active grazing areas, right? So, but also this is, of course, it's a nice exercise. It shows the flexibility, but we really need to see if the ensemble land use and land cover map, it's actually better than the inputs, right? So we really need to have some kind of reference validation data set. So maybe we can use some data set that it's already around, like GLANS or the C GLOPS, right, produced by our IASA colleagues, but or even like produce a new training data so we can assess that. And of course, we can have different integration rules, and we even discussed that even the integration rules can be part of a kind of optimization in a machine learning algorithm. And of course, I did that only for 2020, but we also plan to extend the pipeline for working with time series and more land use and land cover classes. So of course, when you add more classes, you really have more complexity, and we need to address that. So because of course, we will have forest and shrubland and things like that, but the concept is basically the same. So that's kind of the idea that and for where we are kind of moving forward. And yeah, thank you for your attention.